Do you want to know what happens during a Raptor engine ignition, or what SpaceX will look like in 20 years, or do you want to witness the end of an era? Then let's dive right in. My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It. We're back from Artemis and from Starbase. Time to dive into rockets, space and the future again. Thank you for joining me today, there's a lot to talk about. Starship updates. SpaceX is incredibly busy with all things Starship. In the past week, while we did our tour to Starbase, SpaceX has accomplished a lot of small and bigger milestones on its road to orbit. One of them certainly is the 7 engine static fire with booster 7. Cosmic Perspective have released a stunning video of the whole process, which I'd like to show you in detail. SpaceX doesn't tell us much about what's happening on the inside of a Raptor engine, as that's their secret sauce. But we can extrapolate a lot of stuff from just observing what the engine does. For the following explanation, keep in mind that all this was derived from outside observation and the few explanations SpaceX has given us. So there might be errors in this, but we should be able to get fairly close to what's actually happening. So to dive right in, the first thing we can see under the super heavy booster as the engines start up is this white vapor. This is gaseous nitrogen. It purges turbopumps and pre-burners to ensure that the following startup is as clean as possible. Any amount of fuel or oxidizer is being purged out of the feed lines and the powerheads themselves. Immediately after the purge is done, you can see hot gas shooting out of the nozzle. You can tell by the turbulence in the air. High pressure gas from the tanks is shooting through the pre-burners. Pressure always wants to flow from high to low, so the pressure going into the engine needs to be higher than what's internally used inside the engine initially. The SpaceX Raptor 2 compared to the Raptor 1 engine has no torch igniters in the main chamber anymore. This is one of the reasons why the engines look so much cleaner on the outside around the main combustion chamber, so right above the engine nozzle. How exactly they make this work is unclear. Musk stated that it wasn't super easy to accomplish, but that they made it happen. It gives them a few huge benefits. As mentioned, a significant complexity reduction, a reduction of failure nodes. It makes the engine lighter, reduces the production cost, and it makes the engine more reliable on ignition. Overall, it was a huge improvement to get rid of the torch igniters in the main chamber. However, there are still torch igniters in the oxygen and fuel power heads. Powerhead in this case means the turbopump and pre-burner assembly. Chief was on site as well, taking some stunning footage of the test. In general, the startup sequence of a Raptor engine is pretty complex, as both oxygen and fuel powerheads run on different shafts, whereas, for example, the Merlin engine runs both oxygen and fuel turbopump on the same shaft, so mechanically locked and with the same RPM. If you like this kind of footage, support us on Patreon to achieve our next goal. A link can be found in the info card and in the description of this video. On a Raptor engine, both turbopumps and pre-burners are on separate shafts, and they even cross-feed each other, making the startup sequence insanely complex. Musk explained it as a delicate dance between fuel and oxygen powerhead. If anything goes out of sync, you can melt your pre-burner. Once it's running, it's a much easier to handle beast, but while it's starting up, it's easy to melt or even explode an engine. There are literally hundreds of things happening simultaneously until this happens: main chamber ignition. In real time, the whole process takes around 1.5 seconds, and that's exactly what makes this so difficult to achieve. Ryan Hansen Space made a quick animation highlighting the engines used for the static fire and the order in which they were ignited. Interesting to note here is that these were not the engines used on a later static fire, but those from the spin prime test earlier that day.
Even though we just saw SpaceX ignite 7 Raptor engines simultaneously for roughly 7 seconds on September 19th, this might open your eyes to the significance of this milestone. Next, we should see them ignite 20 Raptor engines if they are still following their internal plans.
Before we can see more action, SpaceX needs to make a few more improvements to Booster 7. As seen here in this wonderful SpaceX drone footage, it was rolled back to the production site on September 22nd. The official word from SpaceX? Booster 7 transported back to the Starship factory for robustness upgrades ahead of the flight.
That's right. We got another estimate from Elon for a possible launch window. Late next month, maybe, but November seems highly likely. We will have two boosters and ships ready for orbital flight by then, with full stack production at roughly one every 2 months. And yes, Booster 7 is still planned to launch first. According to Elon, SpaceX is taking a little risk there. Engine isolation on Booster 7 was done as a retrofit or as an afterthought, so it's not as good as on Booster 9. Remember how I said earlier that it's really easy to melt or even explode an engine if anything goes wrong during the powerhead spin-up? To launch Super Heavy, SpaceX will have to ignite 33 engines in a sequence that minimizes stress on the main thrust structure of the rocket, while at the same time being prepared for a catastrophic failure. Engine isolation means that each engine is in a separate compartment, which on Booster 7 isn't the case. So Booster 9 will have yet another major change to its engine bay. Chief also took some stunning footage of a recent sound suppression system test at the Starbase launch site. Water vapor can be seen sprayed out into the middle of the orbital launch mount. This system will undoubtedly be used to mitigate shockwaves created by the engines and bounced up against the rocket again. It's good to see that the system is making good progress. Time will tell if this is enough to tame 33 Raptors on Ignition. More and more information is coming to us that SpaceX is planning to move one of their boosters to Kennedy Space Center via ships before the end of this year. Greg Scott was up in the air again taking some incredible pictures. The Y team substantially supports Greg's and Fariel's work on Patreon. More flights are needed and we couldn't possibly do this alone. Looking at these latest pictures shows the progress on the Florida Star Factory. Not long and the building will be usable for first test work. Launches will likely have to wait until the second half of 2023, but we're very much looking forward to that happening here in Florida. On September 11th, SpaceX rolled the final segment of Mechazilla 2 out towards Pad 39A and later stacked it onto the tower. Its main structure is finished now. That doesn't mean it's operational. There are quite a few things still missing. Chopsticks, QD arm, hydraulic system components. Fariel, who joins Greg on flyovers, took this picture of the draw works for the new Mechazilla at Pad 39A. It's almost the same system as in Boca Chica as depicted here in one of SpaceX 3D creation Eccentric's wonderful animations. We can also see more and more parts for a third Mechazilla at Roberts Road. Where this tower will be built is still unknown, but there are a few possible locations. Either at future Pad 49 to be constructed north of Pad 39B at the old planned location for the Apollo Pad 39C which never got built, or at Pad 39A which would take the pad to the next level with two Starship towers. A third possible option would be the Falcon 9 landing zones. If you haven't done so yet, join me on Twitter and Instagram at Felix Schlang to be part of the greater discussion. There still is a lot of debate between NASA and SpaceX about a possible catch at Pad 39A, and even though the Mechazilla at the pad will be capable of catching, it doesn't mean that this will necessarily happen right away. Priority number one is to get the system operational as fast as possible. If this means building an extra Mechazilla at the landing zones to get catching at the Cape and to show NASA that it can be done reliable, that's what SpaceX would do. It'll be very interesting for sure. Did you like the episode so far? Remember to hit the like button and subscribe to the channel and ring the bell to support us and get a reminder when the next one hits YouTube. SpaceX launched another batch of Starling satellites to orbit on September 24th. It was SpaceX's 43rd orbital mission for 2022. SpaceX's previous record for most launches in 1 year was last year's 31 launches. So SpaceX is on track to set yet another consecutive record number. The launch went perfect with a pinpoint landing on SpaceX's drone ship, a shortfall of gravitas, out on the Atlantic Ocean. There doesn't seem to be an obvious limit to booster reusability, and Starlink launches, besides being very important for SpaceX's future, are the testbed for Falcon 9 reusability. Musk stated before that some parts would need to be replaced, but that 100 plus flights with a Falcon 9 booster would be possible. On September 10th, they showed that well beyond 10 isn't a problem. B1058.14 lifted off from LC39A for Starlink 4-2 and landed on a shortfall of gravitas. Done. Onwards to 15. Incredible. From first to last, ULA has launched the last Delta IV heavy rocket on the West Coast ever.
From its early beginnings as a weapons system through its transformation to a commercial launch vehicle, the Delta family of ULA rockets has seen a lot. And September 24th marked the end of the line.
At least on the West Coast.
Titled by United Launch Alliance as the most metal rocket of all, Delta IV ignited itself on every launch to burn off excess hydrogen bleed, giving its unique look on every flight. And yes, that does look pretty metal.
Delta IV took off for one last time from the East Coast without a problem for the Nrol 91 launch out of Vandenberg, California.
14 flights total from December 21st of 2004 until September 24th of 2022.
Two more flights are left in 2023 and 2024 from the Cape Canaveral Space Force Station.
Having only one partial failure right at the start and on its maiden flight with the common booster cores underperforming and resulting in a lower orbit than planned, Delta IV Heavy can be counted among the top tier of reliable rockets.
I'll miss those Delta IV Heavy launches out of Vandenberg. Thanks for the show, ULA. From the past into the future, Polaris Dawn is getting ready for a spectacular mission.
Anna, Kid, Rook, Sarah. Remember those names, for they will go down in spaceflight history as the first completely private mission of the Polaris program. The program consists of up to 3 human spaceflight missions that will demonstrate new technologies, conduct extensive research, and ultimately culminate in the first flight of SpaceX's Starship with humans on board. So much for SpaceX's official word. No earlier than March 2023, SpaceX will launch a Falcon 9 rocket. It will carry Polaris Dawn, a modified Crew Dragon, into low Earth orbit to start a program to research important technologies needed to advance human space exploration. Among the firsts of this flight is the first ever private extravehicular activity, or EVA. And the 4 SpaceX astronauts are training hard for this mission. A fighter jet training weekend on the 17th and 18th of September. That week before that, EVA training and a visit to SpaceX's Starbase. Centrifuge training, low oxygen chamber, the whole deal. The plan is to have a hatch at the top of the capsule where the universal docking adapter needed to dock with the ISS normally is. The crew will be protected by a yet-to-be-shown EVA suit, and part of the mission will take place outside the capsule. NASA has done this many times, but an entirely private mission has never performed this dangerous task. It is very much needed preparation for future Moon and Mars missions, and it is one of the first steps to turn SpaceX into more than just a launch provider. Astronaut training and mission planning and execution are normally parts of NASA's work. Having had the pleasure of talking to 2 of the Inspiration 4 astronauts by now, recently with Jared Isaacman on a wonderful livestream by Felix's Spacetime, made me realize once more that SpaceX's plans go far beyond building rockets and launching them. We're at the very beginning of a much greater idea of being a full-service provider. SpaceX's plans involve everything needed, from constructing reusable rockets, training astronauts, and executing missions, all directed by one private company.
What will SpaceX look like 10 or 20 years from now? Let me know your thoughts in the comments. And if you have the same opinion as I do, head out to our YWare merch store and buy yourself a brand new Becoming Multiplanetary shirt by Tony Bela. Today, I'd like to thank Surfshark VPN for sponsoring yet another Y episode. When traveling, a VPN is just a good thing to have. You can protect your identity and make it harder for the average hacker kid to get into your personal files. But did you know that VPNs can be used for much more than that?
They can also help you to reduce your travel spendings. Have you ever noticed that flights, cars, and hotels seem to get more and more expensive the more you look for them online?
Price discrimination is not a nice thing to do by the industry, but you can be smarter.
By implementing tracking cookies and IP tracking, they try to track your behavior. Once they find a pattern, they'll ramp up prices on exactly the flights and hotels you're likely to book.
There's a simple solution for it. Activate Surfshark and change your virtual location to wherever you want to travel and unblock cheaper flights and hotel prices. Problem solved.
Changing your virtual location also gives you access to different content on streaming services. Just change the server, refresh the page, and on we go with the next movie marathon.
While all this is happening in the background, Surfshark VPN doesn't track your activity either. I use Surfshark every day on my PC and my smartphone. In fact, it automatically starts up whenever I turn on my PC. Head over to surfshark.deals/Felix and enter my promo code Felix for 83% off plus 3 extra months for free. Surfshark, surf with your own set of rules. That's it for today. Thank you very much for watching and I'll see you again on Friday. Plenty sure. Multi-plenty. Hacker Kid, Hacker Joe. There might be errors in this line that I wrote. Aww, you should see the cat right now. Means the turbo pump, created by the engines. Cut it in half.